Okay, Trish. He just gave us.
Ready?
Okay, go ahead. Trish, he's ready. Thomas just gave us this.
Oh,
I'm having her do it.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning, everyone. Please stand and sing with us. An oldie but goodie.
Glory to God in the highest. Glory to God in the highest. Glory to God in the highest. He's on earth. Glory to God in the highest. Glory to God in the highest. Glory to God in the highest. He's on earth. Was a babe born in Bethlehem, a humble star, not a room at the inn. A star shone bright to announce his birth. The angels sang throughout heaven and earth. They sang, glory to God in the highest. Glory to God in the highest. Glory to God in the highest. He's on. They grew up to become a man, performing miracles across the land. He taught of love and a will for men, and God's forgiveness for all our sins. He said, glory to God in the highest. Glory to God in the highest. Glory to God in the highest. He's on. Just a man died upon a cross, and his disciples thought that all was lost. But he arose after 3 full days to cleanse our sins, and we now give praise. We sing, glory to God in the highest. Glory to God in the highest. Glory to God in the highest. He's on earth.
One more time.
Glory to God in the highest. Glory to God in the highest. Glory to God in the highest. He's on earth. He's on earth. He's on earth.
Good morning. You may be seated. And welcome to worship at Community Presbyterian Church. It is my joy to welcome you today. My name is Reverend Melanie Marsh Baum, and I am the senior pastor here at Community. And whether you are joining us for the very first time, whether you are visiting from out of town, whether you have been here from day one, our worship today is different and special because of you. Because you are here, and we could not do this without you. In fact, we would not even want to. And so it is a joy each Sunday to gather together in worship, and especially during the Advent season when we celebrate Christ with us, God made human and living with us. Today, you might notice that our worship space looks a little bit different. We give great thanks to our property committee and our staff for helping facilitate painting of our worship space over the last couple of days, and we hope that it will bring new energy into the space as we have this little bit of added brightness in our midst, and we hope that you are enjoying this Advent season. Today is the third week of Advent, and our word of the day is joy. We light the pink candle in just a few minutes to remind us of the joy of the season, even when that joy is a little bit hard to find and recognize. And as we prepare to greet our community, I invite Thomas to come forward with a few seasonal announcements.
Seasonal indeed.
Good morning, friends. It's good to be with you, and it's good to be in worship with you. For those of you who are on Facebook and enjoying our worship online, we remind you to like and share this morning's service to spread the good word of the Lord to all corners of the earth. Some of the things that you'll find today, our first announcement, poinsettias. That's the little green insert in your bulletin. They are $10, and you have until the end of the week to get those orders in to the front office. Any questions, you can contact the front office or the wonderful Cindy Anderson. Cindy, wave. There she is. Thank you, Cindy. Second is our blue insert, which you might not have, but our ushers can come around and help you with. This is our 2022 flower calendar. Through your graces, we've been able to fill out most of the year, but we do have 16 dates still available to fill out the rest of the calendar. So if you are interested in partaking in that, ushers have a form that you can pick up now or at the end of the service. Next is our Christmas VBS, which is occurring later on this month. Okay. Christmas VBS, sign up your children, tell your friends, tell your neighbors. The wonderful Melissa Daniel, our Christian educator here, has put together a two-day event that is going to be amazing. Melissa, is there anything else?
Sign up yourself for volunteering.
On the opposite side of that page, you can find the volunteer form. And that is on your purple. Two other quick announcements. Robert, can you hold up an attendance pad? These attendance pads are very important, especially to our volunteers in the office. Please make sure to sign in so we can make sure that you are signed in for attendance. Right now, as I look around, Joe Schreibler has 100% attendance in this quarter. Good job, Joe. And also, the music ministry is excited to announce the reformation of our youth choirs. That will be starting January 5th. It is a Wednesday, and 6:30 in the choir room. If you are between the ages of 4 and 17, the ages are flexible. If you're under the but we invite you all to come out and join us for that. Parents, highly suggest 45 minutes of peace and quiet that I get to deal with your kids. With that, I think that's it. Thank you, Melanie.
Is our custom in this worship service. It's our time for greeting our community. We invite you to stand as you are able and meet one new friend and greet one old friend at least. If you get a few more in, that's an added bonus. But let's stand with one another and greet our community. As we are making our way back to our seats from our greeting time, I invite the little family to come forward to help us with our Advent wreath candle lighting for this morning.
Today we relight the candles of hope and peace. Now we light the third candle of Advent. This is the candle of joy. As the coming of Jesus, our Savior, draws nearer, our joy builds with our anticipation of his birth. Hear the word of the Lord. Sing aloud, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O Israel. Rejoice and exult with all your heart. O daughter of Jerusalem, the Lord has taken away the judgments against you. He has turned away your enemies. The King of Israel, the Lord is in your midst. You shall fear disaster no more.
Please stand if you are able and join us using the words in your bulletin. Surely God is our salvation. We will trust and we will not be afraid.
With joyous expectation, we watch for signs of God's coming.
Give thanks to God, call on God's name, and make known God's deeds among the nations.
With joyous expectation, we watch for signs of God's coming.
Shout aloud and sing for joy, for great in our midst is the Holy One. We light the candle of hope and peace. We light the third candle, the candle of joy. We join the heavens and the earth in passing God's holy name. Let us pray. God of all joy, help us to remember the real cause of happiness in this world, the presence of Jesus in our lives, and the promise of salvation through him. Amen.
And as we prepare our hearts and our minds for worship, please join with me in saying the words together of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We recognize, even as we wait and watch for God's coming into our lives and into our world, the imperfection and the brokenness that we experience in this human existence. We are not perfect, but God is perfect. We are fallible and God is merciful. And so it is with deep gratitude for God's grace and mercy that we confess all that separates us from God and from one another. And we remember that no matter what we do, there is nothing we can do that will make God love us anymore. And there is nothing we can do that will make God love us any less. And so, as redeemed and reconciled members of the body of Christ, beloved children of God, we greet one another with the peace of Christ in worship every week. And so today, I invite you to stand and greet one another, saying, "The peace of Christ be with you," and responding, "And also with you." The peace of Christ be with you, and also with you. Pass the peace to one another. I invite any young worshipers who are in the space with us for worship this morning to join me at the playground for our time for all ages. Going to sit down today because we are all about to stand up and you guys are going to help me in just a second. But today is, you know what's coming. You probably do. So today is the third week of Advent, but it's also the second Sunday of the month. And that means that not only are we celebrating joy in our lives in this Advent season, but we are exactly one of the things that brings us joy is helping other people who need it, right? In fact, we're going to talk about that and hear about that in our scripture this morning. And so one of the things we do to help other people is we collect money, right? Every second Sunday of the month, we collect up change to go for our 2 cents a meal offering. And this offering helps anyone who might be hungry in our neighborhood and all the neighborhoods beyond to get the food that they need. So you guys, your job is to take those buckets that are across the front of the stage and to go around to everyone in the fellowship hall and get their change from them. So I invite you now to go find your favorite color or just a color that is available.
People, let's let it hear it ring. Come on now, drop that stuff in there.
Sure, we haven't missed anybody. I see a couple of people waving their change in the front here. So
people with their hands up here.
I love there's somebody right here who's got some money. There you go. Perfect.
Cutest ushers in the whole wide world.
I know. There's some right there. Perfect. You guys are doing such a great job. And when you're all done, when you've gotten to every single table and every single chair, you can bring your buckets back up to the front. Oh, give them to Miss Melissa, who is coming to the front. Well done. Yay. Not ready. We'll wait for you. You don't have to worry about that.
I got $3.
Hey. All right. And when we put all our buckets away, let's say a quick prayer. Can you guys pray with me? Dear God, thank you for your love. Thank you for the joy it brings us. And help us to share it with others. Amen.
Continue with that attitude of giving. We're going to our ushers prepared to take up our tithes and offering this morning. Of course, we always brag on what a good job you guys do. On when I tell you what the mission of the month is or something like that, and you guys always respond in great ways. Well, if you remember, we took up, Melissa, you got to help me out here. She's still in here with us. We took up puzzles and games, and we made gifts for our friends at Pablo Towers. And so this past week, I did a devotion over on Thursday afternoon or Thursday morning, and they were getting ready to hand out the gifts, doing a birthday party and doing a Christmas celebration. And so I asked, she took me in the back room and was showing me what a great job this church has done in providing those. And there were 58 puzzle books, 28 Surge, 14 crosswords, 21 games, 58 jigsaw puzzles, 137 total gifts that were donated by you guys and wrapped and prepared by our deacons. Melissa's put the picture. Yes, give yourselves a round of applause. Great job, all of you guys. Melissa's put the pictures that they sent us about from the party on the website. So check it out if you would. It was, I mean, you guys, again, responded in a big way. And our friends at Pablo Towers say thank you, and Pablo Hamlet say thank you very much. The group that I was leading the devotion with that morning was just excited that, and I asked them, I said, are you guys going to be here for Christmas? Some of them had families here. Some of them didn't have family here. And they were looking forward to the party and all the festivities around the towers so that they would have people to celebrate Christmas with. And so you guys made it very special, and we thank you for that in a big way. All the ways, again, I say it each week, and I hope it doesn't become just redundant to you or fall on deaf ears. We appreciate your giving. We appreciate the way that you respond to missions here in the church and the support of this church and the work that we do in this community. Thank you so much. Let's go to God in prayer. Again, gracious God, I give you thanks for the faithfulness of your people. I give you thanks for your faithfulness and the way that you bless us so that we can be a blessing to the world around us. We ask that you take what we bring you now and use it for your glory in not only this community, but also around the world. And in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Mary, did you know that your baby boy would someday walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you've delivered will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would calm a storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? When you kiss your little baby, you kiss the face of God. Mary, did you know? The blind will see, the deaf will hear, the dead will live again. The lame will leap, the dumb will speak, the praises of the Lamb. Mary, did you know that your baby boy is Lord of all creation? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day rule the nations? Did you know that your baby boy is heaven's perfect lamb? This sleeping child you're holding is the great.
up the prayers of our community around us. I didn't know, Ron, if there were any more prayer request card in the offering plate back there or not. Nope, we're good? Okay. First of all, I want to say a warm welcome to the college students who are returning back. It's good to see you guys. Yes, absolutely. And each week, I'm blessed to see that more and more, see your faces that I haven't seen in a while. Okay. And so it's good to have you guys in our worshiping with us this morning. Yes, that's the second one that I got this morning about that, and that is very tragic. Yeah. Thanks. All right. Let's bow our heads. Gracious and eternal God, yes, Lord of all creation, the one who came with healing on his wings, who was bruised for our iniquities and chastised for us, so that all healing can be granted unto us, O God, spirit, soul, and body. So we approach the throne of grace this morning, standing on your promises and the hope that we have in you to move among us. We know the scriptures tell us that your ears are open to our prayers and that you move across the face of the earth so that you can show yourself whom you can see, show yourself mighty to. So gracious God, we lift up the needs of those around us. We hold up especially those people that were affected by the tornadoes in the tri-state area there. Oh God, be a source of peace for them. Surround that community with the people there that can help them start rebuilding their lives. It won't be the same, oh God, and we know that, but bring these people hope, especially during this time of the year, and let them see that their nation, their churches, their state, their community, all care about them. They're not alone. They're not forgotten about. This is not a battle they have to face by themselves. Remind them of that, oh God. Be a source of peace for them. Again, a source of strength for them. Gracious God, we also hold before you Stan, who is in the hospital and very, very ill. Our friend Laura. We hold before you Emily P. and family. And gracious God, we ask again that you be a source of strength for her, be a source of peace for that family. Guide them with your love. Our brother Anthony, again, we hold him before you, O God, and that family. And we ask that you continue to reach out to them, continue to the process he needs to give him strength, O God, to face the battles that he's facing. For Sarah M., who injured her knee, we ask that you be a source of healing for her. For Todd Z's family, as he passed away from COVID, oh God, we know what a tragic thing that is. And so we ask again that you support them with the promises of the scripture. Guide them. Calm the storms in their life, oh God. For Jan and her family who have suffered the loss, again, of 3 family members. Fill their emptiness, their voids. Help them, guide them. Let the love that's in that family support them and give them strength in the days ahead. For the family of Mandy C., who passed away. And again, during this time, oh God, it's a special time of the year, and it's a difficult thing when someone loses a family member and a friend, a loved one, someone they care about. And again, remind them that you are with them. Calm the storms in their life, ease their anxieties, and uphold them with your love. Holy God, there are many that are on our hearts this morning that we didn't lift up to you. So again, as we stand before your throne of grace to find help in time of need, we hold those before you as well. Oh God, it's in your love that we count on. That brings us peace and brings us hope so that we continue to offer up our prayers to you. And for all the ways that you reach down to us, you know us better than we know ourselves. You know these people that we've held before you better than they know themselves and reach them at the deepest point of their need. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let us adore.
blankets for baby Jesus that we're collecting this month. Please, I didn't mean to overlook that, but if you have some that you'd like to bring into the church, please just drop them off. We're collecting those. You forgot to announce that we're having a cantata next week, okay? How can the music director forget that he's a cantata next week? And both services are in the sanctuary. How could a pastor forget to tell people that their services are in the sanctuary? Oh, my gosh. What kind of crowd do we have around here? Our first scripture reading comes to us this morning from Philippians chapter 4. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, will guard your hearts and your mind in Christ Jesus. Our first reading.
Our second scripture reading this morning comes to us from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 3, verses 7 to 18. The story of John the Baptist baptizing in the wilderness. And he says, John said to the crowd that came to be baptized by him, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath that is to come? Bear fruits worthy of repentance. Do not begin to say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our ancestor,' for I tell you, God can raise up from these stones children to Abraham. And even now, the axe is lying at the root of the tree. Every tree, therefore, that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire." And the crowds asked him, "What then should we do?" And in reply, he said to them, "Whoever has two coats, give one away to someone who has none. And whoever has food must do likewise." Even tax collectors came to be baptized, and they asked him, "Teacher, what should we do?" And he said to them, "Collect no more than the amount prescribed for you." And soldiers also asked him, "And we, what should we do?" And he said to them, "Do not extort money from anyone by threats or false accusations, and be satisfied with your wages." And as the people were filled with expectation, all were questioning in their hearts concerning John whether he might be the Messiah. And John answered all of them by saying, "I baptize you with water, but one who is coming is more powerful than I, and I am not worthy to untie the thong of his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand to clear his threshing floor and to gather the wheat into his granary. But the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire." So with many other exhortations, he proclaimed the good news to the people of God. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. For weeks, Daniel had been doing mindless, meaningless grunt work for his neighbor, Mr. Miyagi. Sanding the floor of his deck, painting the sides of his house, waxing his car. Mr. Miyagi had promised to teach Daniel martial arts, but instead, here he was, waxing and painting until he thought his arms would fall off. He knew the motions of each task. He thought he could probably do them in his sleep. Wax on, wax off. But what he couldn't tell you is what any of this had to do with learning karate. He was getting tired of Mr. Miyagi's nonsense. So late one evening, after a long day of waxing the car again, Daniel decided to confront his neighbor. Full of teenage angst and frustration, Daniel ranted at the old man, talking on and on about how Mr. Miyagi was wasting his time as Miyagi silently tended to his garden. Finally, As Daniel was ready to walk away in anger and never come back, Miyagi turned to his young student and said to him, "Not everything is as it seems." He instructed Daniel to go through the motions of the tasks he had been doing again. "Show me sand the floor," Miyagi said to his student. "Show me paint side to side. Show me wax on, wax off." Daniel moved through the mundane actions one by one, but this time, something remarkable happened. Suddenly, in the midst of this routine repetition, Miyagi lunges at the boy in a violent attack of punches and kicks and jabs, and instinctively, Daniel moved to block every single attack, matching Miyagi's every move in a wordless and effortless dance. It was as if something inside of Daniel had come alive in that moment, and he was filled with an exhilaration that he had never known from simply waxing and sanding and painting. When it was all over, Daniel stood there in stunned silence. Teacher and student met one another's gaze, and Miyagi bowed before Daniel. "Come back tomorrow," he said. In that moment, Daniel realized that everything he'd been doing that he thought had nothing to do with karate actually had everything to do with karate. And this is a truth that many people of all kinds, athletes and other creative types of people, all know. It is one thing to know the right movements. It is a different thing entirely for the practice to come alive inside of your body. You can know the mechanics of a thing, where to put your hands on the right keys, how to hold the bat or throw the ball toward the net. It's one thing to know the moves and be able to hit the right note, but until you embody the practice, until it is in your muscles, in your bones, until it moves within your soul, it will never come to life. Knowledge is imparted from the outside, but understanding, that comes from within. And it does not come from simply learning the right answers, but from allowing all that you have learned to transform you, transform who you are fundamentally. So in this third week of Advent, we are meant to be focused on joy. Yet as we listen to this morning scripture reading, we might be wondering how John the Baptist's words could possibly be seen as any kind of good news. Like Daniel with his friend Mr. Miyagi, it's hard for us to see what any of this might have to do with joy. Yet here we are, and this is our scripture. Good news? Well, maybe so. It all depends on your perspective, and it all depends on who's hearing it. And it might help us to understand what's going on here if we get a little bit of background on the people who had come to hear John's words at the Jordan River. So we know that John the Baptist was the last in the line of the great prophets of Israel. And although John never called himself a prophet, he was the embodiment of the entire tradition. He looked like Elijah, dressed in the same kind of clothes, sounded like Isaiah with his words that he used, and he was standing in the very waters that marked the boundary between the wilderness and the promised land. And by this point in his ministry, John had gained quite a following of people, and they were a very diverse group. Many came from among the lowest classes of people within the Roman Empire. Others were faithful Jews from his own community. And among this group, the faithful Jews of his own community were some rather powerful and influential people, Pharisees and Sadducees, who had heard of John's new practice of baptism as a sign of repentance and forgiveness of sins. They wanted to come to check out this new ritual and to take part in it, if that was what you were supposed to do in order to show your faithfulness to God. Yet as they gathered with the rest, John calls out this group specifically as a brood of vipers. He questions their motives and asks who warned them to come and take part in this ritual. Because you see, for John, repentance is not just about going through motions. It was about true, fundamental transformation. This is why when he saw the Pharisees and Sadducees getting in line to be baptized with the rest, John was instantly skeptical. You have to remember that the Pharisees were the famous rule followers of this gospel story, sort of like the hall monitors of the Hebrew people. If there was a rule about anything, these men were going to make sure that they were following it and that everybody knew about it. It was this group that would tail Jesus throughout his own earthly ministry, watching to catch him breaking the Sabbath or eating with an outcast so that they could call him out in front of the temple leadership and show that he was breaking the rules. John's claim was that the people of Israel had to repent of their sin and be baptized with water to prepare for the coming of the Messiah. And so it was no surprise when the Pharisees got wind of this new rule being set out for the children of Israel, this baptism ritual, they had to get in on the action. Nobody was going to stop them from being seen as following a rule that they were supposed to be following. But you see, knowing this rule was not the point. John might have been the bridge linking Jesus with the ancient tradition of prophecy, but John's message was also significantly different from his prophetic ancestors. Because with John, no longer is the message abide by the rules and you will be punished. No longer is the message you will be rewarded for your acts of piety. No, John was there telling the world that in Jesus, the kingdom of heaven has come to earth. He warned these men that their outward shows of faithfulness were not going to protect them this time. It was not enough to appear to be doing what was right in the eyes of God, because the one who has come will look not at our actions, but will see into our hearts and know our deepest motives. So what can we do to show our true repentance? Well, John says that's simple. You love others. You give to those who have nothing. You do not profit from anyone's misfortune or take advantage of the vulnerable. And above all, you must rejoice in all things. Christ's birth, Christ's life and death and resurrection, they marked a new era, defined by reconciliation rather than by divisions, where how you dressed, or what you said, or which rule you followed, was not nearly as important as who you love, how you care for the lowest and the least, when you have the power to do so. This message, then, would have sounded like very good news, of great joy, to all of those in the crowd whose lives were lived on the edge. The ones who have nothing were suddenly given a message of hope. Things will be given to you by those who have enough to give. But the ones who had everything were given a kind of warning. Your status, your rule following, your privilege, none of that is going to save you this time. But they were also reminded that it is not too late for them either. Because God cares about how faith transforms our hearts and how that transformation changes the way that we live. You see, this is what John meant when he said, bear fruit that is worthy of repentance. Because we may know all the rules. We might say all the right words, but if they do not reside in our hearts and make a difference in how we encounter the world around us, our rules and our words, they're meaningless. We will never know true joy as long as we practice a faith that is only on the surface of our lives. One of the most enduring and beloved stories of Christmas is the tale of Ebenezer Scrooge, as told in Charles Dickens' A Christmas Carol. Over the course of one Christmas Eve night, the miserable old Scrooge is guided by three spirits into a reckoning with his own cruelty, his own loneliness and pain, as he watches the Christmases of his life pass before his eyes. The events of that night leave Scrooge radically changed. And what makes Scrooge such a captivating character is that his is a story of true and complete transformation. He did not simply try to follow the spirit's advice now and then and be from that day forward, you know, just kind of nice to his fellow human beings. No. For the rest of Scrooge's life, he allowed the experience of that Christmas Eve night to live within him. Joy came alive for him, and he chose to embrace it. To the depths of his heart, he became a new creation, as good a man, as good a master, and as good a friend as anyone ever knew. Repentance is like that. We walk the path, we learn the steps, yet we truly repent when we allow the journey to seep in and transform who we are. Advent is an opportunity for us to make ready our hearts, minds, and spirits for the arrival of Christ. And like those early followers of John the Baptist, we are called to repent as we wait for the arrival of God. We are called to let the gift of God's great love radically change how we see the world around us, how we treat our friends, the stranger, and even our enemies. John the Baptist came to proclaim that it is not about what we do. We are not the key to this equation any longer, because our joy is found in the power of God's love. The arrival of Christ is God's gift to all of us, a love poured out for all people. And we may never be good enough, kind enough, or faithful enough. That's not the point. The point is that Christ still comes. God is with us. The kingdom of heaven is here and now, turning our lives anew into something transformed. And this truly is good news. This is our reason for joy. Amen. As we prepare to hear our closing music this morning, I invite you to take with you this question. Where do I need to turn my life around in this season? Who do I need to see? Where do I need to rediscover joy in order for true turning, true repentance to come alive within me? And may we all find joy in this Advent season.
Please stand and sing with us.
Come ye, O come ye, to Bethlehem.
As friends, as we depart from worship this morning, just one quick reminder that next week this service will be held at 9 o'clock in the sanctuary so that we might all enjoy the cantata together. And as we go out into this week and into the waiting world, may we find joy in the places where it is easy to see and the places where it is more difficult. And may God's love transform us from the inside out, today and always. As we go from this place, know that the immeasurable love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit goes with you, now and in the days to come. Amen. Amen.